yesterday is how their purpose is connected to our identity. And you know, when we are helping others, it truly is when I believe you start to discover God's purpose for you. You know, so many times we live in a world that's like me, 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 self-help, 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 and how can I grow me, grow me? And I think that the shift of really what God wants Christian leaders especially to do so that they can be the example and then give that to others is to say, you know, the beginning of discovering God's purpose for me is helping and serving others. That's when he's going to reveal it to me. You know, if you minister through someone in your own pain, you know, every time you help someone, you'll lose sight of your own pain because you get outside of yourself. And Isaiah 58:10, it says, feed the hungry and help those in trouble. Then your light will shine out from the darkness, and the darkness around you will be as bright as the noonday sun. So we have to lose sight of our own need. And Jesus, in all of his agony on the cross, he's not focused on his pain. Remember, what was he focused on? The two men beside him. Just picture that lesson. Like, wow. He was able to take his sight off the most tremendous pain that we can't even imagine and focus on the people around him that were in the pain. Now, do you think we could do the same? I mean, I know I couldn't probably be in that much pain. It just, right? It would just be so hard. But we can, at some extent, to say, you know what? There's probably a purpose of this pain that I have, and it can be used to help minister to someone else. So when we get outside of ourselves, something incredible happens within us. And you know, your pain is purposed for hope. For hope. That's the number one thing this world needs right now, is hope. And your purpose is perfectly positioned to give others hope. You just need to know your story. You know, what God has done for you and the purpose for your pain to bring hope to those that he is gonna trust in your path. So I went through something to get to the other side to help someone who's walking down the same path. So understand your path that you have uniquely walked down. God is going to have your path intersect with other people's path. He already has it mapped out. So aren't we grateful that Jesus went through what he did to give us hope, for us to be able to get on the other side one day? So there are people on the other side of what you have gone through and are going through. So last night, we tackled our first two scars, our scars of forgiveness, our scars of remembrance of what God has gotten through. And today, as I said, my favorite scar is that there's a what I call a message, the message scars. That God has a scar, but it's now that can become our message to give hope and help to others. So we're going to meet my friend, Angela, who I'm so excited for the opportunity for y'all to hear her story. And I think about the first day. You know, it's just so cool, again, how God does align paths. And I just think, Angela, about that day. I think it was at a CF something. I know I was there, I think, with the coaches. I think it was the leader coaches and doing that. But I can just remember and just, you know, when you just see someone's purity in their heart. And that was just so evident, just seeing Angela and her heart for others and for women. And then just being able, I can remember the breakfast that you, Sonia, and I had, and just then getting to know you and the beginning of that friendship and that relationship and just walking alongside and seeing your son grow now and just all, and then now your story. So let's go ahead and meet Angela. Angela Ball, replacing fear, trauma, and insecurity with love, grace, and the mercy of God. That is Angela Ball's life work. Angela is a native of Colombia, South America, and immigrated on her own to the U.S. at the young age of 15 while in high school. Angela is married to her amazing husband of 27 years, Ray, and have an incredibly tall 18-year-old, we need a picture of him, right? Ashton, that loves basketball, is now preparing to sail away to college to study sports management and business. Today, we will hear about Angela's story that led her to her own transformation and realize that her pain turned into purpose, inspiring her to support single moms. As her heart broke for this population, as As your heart broke for this population, Angela has served single mom for 11 years and 5 years ago founded Heart for Moms in West Palm. Currently serves as the executive director. Also, Angela attended Christ Fellowship Leadership College, which helped grow her leadership skills. Heart for Moms' mission is to provide resources to enrich the lives of single moms and their children. Heart for Moms' goal is to help the moms become whole and find hope and freedom through the body of Christ and God's word. Angela encouraged us all to live out our faith, give single moms hope, and show them our love. So we're so excited. Watching you, and now just recently being able to start to tell your story,
right.
and it's so cool, you guys, when you meet people and you get to watch the evolving that God is doing,
right.
And the blessings. And one thing I have just respected and admired about you is you always give Him the glory.
Amen.
Always give Him the glory. So I so love and respect that. So just tell us a little bit about you and your childhood, and maybe how that impacted you and who you are.
Thank you, Amy. Ladies, it's a pleasure and an honor to be here. I just want to, again, give all the glory to the Lord, that He continues to use me just to be able to speak to you. And I'm excited. I'm thankful for this opportunity, Amy. The Lord has released me on completely sharing part of my mess. And it's incredible how our messes turn into our message, right? So we just need to make sure that we tap into that place of healing. And this was such a good question because sometimes we just don't know it as we continue to do life. But the Lord will bring it to mind. He will show you because His desire is to equip you and to make you whole so that you can do His work. So it's been a journey. It's been a journey that I was not expecting whatsoever. I like to say that this was not on my bucket list. I was not planning. I was like, hey, I'm gonna be doing ministry. That was not something that I planned at all. And I'm just glad that the Lord brought me to a place where I needed to do that. Because again, we need to do something. There's a deeper purpose that we have been born with. And for us to be able to discover our purpose and really step into our calling is a great opportunity to be able to partner with the best partner ever, our Lord and Savior. And again, just to see everything unfold. So I apologize. Could you repeat the question again?
Her story. What I love is you're going to hear how her story unfolded. And, you know, last night Lisa kind of set up and positioned that for us. And, you know, we're going to be working on our own story today. So as you're listening to Angela, because she has her story, but all of us, all of you have this, your God story too. So just be thinking about that. But tell us just how you grew up and how that kind of shaped and helped, you know, who you are today.
So I am an immigrant from Colombia, South America. I actually came here at age 15. I was just coming here for summer vacation. I had no clue that this was going to be my home. And it was amazing because I came over and I just had, my mom was going through a divorce and I just told my mom, Mom, it's easier for you to take care of my two sisters as a single mom now than having three and have to take care of them. So let me just stay for a year and, you know, we'll figure things out. Well, the Lord had bigger plans and I remained here and was able to meet my husband and do all those things. But I had to really humble myself because I had to survive. I had to do what I needed to do. And in order to be able to continue to go to school, I was an international student, so I was going full time to school, but I also needed to work, so I needed to clean houses. And to this day, I'm so thankful that I was able to clean houses. Is it something that we want to do? No, because we definitely don't want to clean anyone else's toilet, right? I mean, I'm sorry, but who wants to do that? But again, at the same time, it just taught me so much. So what I can say from my experiences is that every experience is so valuable. Do not discard your experiences, because you're gaining knowledge. You are gaining something new that you never know you're gonna use. Like, to this day, if we need to get on our knees and clean up whatever needs to be cleaned up, we're gonna do it. No job is too small, right? And when he trusts you with the little things, he will trust you with the bigger things. So that was part of the evolution of coming in here and then being able to have an amazing family, and then how the Lord worked it out afterwards.
I love that you said, you know, when you'll be faithful in the little things, then keep the big things.
Right.
And, you know, we touch the surface of that. And that's a big part, I think, of this weekend, of so much. We think the world is, it has to be big right away. But there's so many steps along the way before God can give you the next. So I'm excited. So think back as far as you can. If you can think back to the first time you thought, oh, this is maybe what I wanted when I grow up. Or, you know, this is maybe what my future, like, what was that when you look back?
So I really wanted to be an interior designer. That's what I wanted to do. And let's put me in Home Goods. I can be there all day long. I just love designing and putting things together. But then ended up moving with my husband because of the industry that he was in overseas. So we lived overseas. And it kind of put a hold onto my college education. So ladies, I don't have a degree. I don't have a degree. And it's amazing how the enemy will use that. Please be mindful of that, because even as he started unfolding this plan, I felt so ill-equipped for every single part of it. And again, it started with a yes. It started with the first yes of wanting to serve him, right? Because my life was radically transformed when I finally gave my life to Christ. And that was not that long ago. I'm 51 years old now, and I was about 38, 39. I wish I had that date down, but I don't. But I know that's when I actually gave my life to Christ, and that's when everything changed for me. So yes, I had different dreams, different aspirations. Even after we got back, you know, I wanted to do something else. I started getting into the marketing industry. That was just something that I ended up going into, and the Lord gave me those skills, learned those skills, which now I'm able to apply to what I'm doing today. I'm not saying that I'm an expert on it, but I definitely am able to use some of those gifts to be able to implement them. So.
And I know a little bit, you know, about your story, and one of the things I think is neat is that you did come to know Jesus later in life. You know, you weren't someone who it grew up and you have that planted so firmly. So tell us a little bit about that journey and how Jesus did come to your life and what that looked like.
So I attend Christ Fellowship. Woohoo to Christ Fellowship. And ladies, I was the perfect CEO. Christmas, Easter only. That's what Pastor Todd says all of the time. We don't want to be CEOs. I grew up Catholic. And again, when I came over here, there was just a gap. There was something missing. And I'm like, Lord, I'm going to go church hopping, because I need to be filled. So that's when I started going to different churches. And I really, truly needed to leave my judgments outside any of the doors. So I highly encourage you, listen, everyone else's experience is their own experience, and it's not your own. So you have to leave that at the door wherever you go. And I remember stepping into now my church, Christ Fellowship, and again, it radically transformed me, because I knew that was, like, I could not stop crying. I was boo-hooing the whole time. And every time I will attend and show up, that's exactly what was happening. And then he started surrounding me with amazing Christian brothers and sisters in Christ. I love my sisters and brothers. And they started introducing me to the Word. And that's when, through Belkis, which maybe some of you know, she was the one that brought me to Christ. And that was the beginning of my journey. But I also knew that, listen, I love my husband. We've been married for 27 years. We dated for 5 years. So it's been a while that we've been together. But I also had to realize that he had his journey, but I needed to start my own because my life was turned upside down. My priority was my family and my son. I was so wrong. Once I started getting into the Word, I realized that my priority needed to be God, and then everything else falls under it. And when I did that, I'm like, love, I'm yours after 10. I'm taking my son, our son, not just mine, I'm taking Ashton with me so that we can go to church, and then after that, we're gonna have fun. I was not the nagging wife, and I think that's important, but I did cover him in prayer. And suddenly, he asked, hey, maybe I'm gonna join you to go to church. I'm like, really? I'm like, cool, let's do it. Well, you know that the food was the thing that actually drew him to church? I'm like, Lord, you use everything. And like, he did give his life to Christ. So it's just amazing. It's incredible what the Lord does.
So now you have found Jesus. Amen. Right? So, but because of some of the things in your past, there was some shame and guilt that you were carrying into this new relationship. So how did that play a part into it? How did you kind of handle and process all that?
So at age 19, and some of you know my story, at age 19, I became pregnant and I justified my choices because I had an abortion. And I wish I knew then what I know. And ladies, I carried that pain, that shame for so long. Because that was my baby. Can I tell you, I'm actually being so released.
Yeah.
And that's why the Lord has been so clear about sharing. I just identify with some of you. And I want you to know that there's so much healing. And by His stripes, we have been healed.
Yes.
You don't have to carry it anymore. You just need to leave it at His feet. I started reading this book, Heaven is for Real.
Yes.
Oh, come on, how many of you have read that book? If you haven't, you have to read that book. I know that you all have watched, was probably the movie, but the book, oh, it really gets you. It's so good. And I remember being in my bedroom. And again, I'm so new, right? I'm like a little baby, just wanting more. And so I remember being in my bedroom and reading this book, and I'm boo-hooing because it's the part that Mom is talking to Colton about this girl that he met. This little girl that he met that had no name. And she had never shared her story about the baby, his sister. And she never gave her a name. And clearly, she had to give her a name. So my baby boy is Jonathan. And that's, it's just so good. Because I know that one day, we're a really small family, but we truly are a huge family. And miscarriage happened even after my son was born. After he was 3 years old, I miscarried twice. And it brought me back to my mess, although there was healing that was beginning. And at that point, I'm like, Lord, did I lose these two babies because you're punishing me? I was so wrong. I remember sitting, I entered into a state of depression, ladies. I had never, ever, ever had felt that before. And I'm so glad that I have now. I'm so glad that I'm able to speak about it. I'm glad that I'm able to relate with any of you that are going through or have gone through it, because it's not an easy thing. But I'm also glad that I was able to bring it right to the Lord every single time. And when I went to that place of punishment, are you punishing me because I had an abortion? It was so clear that it was not. It was so clear as day Then he told me, have I not given you a son? That was the end of it for me. I knew at that time I had an inspiration, time and day, to move forward and to appreciate the blessings of him giving me a son. And no, he was not punishing me for my mistakes. That's not our God. And so through that pain, who would have thunk it that this was going to happen? Hello, again, not on my bucket list. This is not like, yes, this is what I'm going to do. But I just wanted to do something. And that's the part. There's something in you that you want to do something at some point. Ephesians 2:10 tells us that we are Christ's workmanship. He has created us to do his good works that he prepared way in advance for us to do. But the to do part is what is key. And so as I started doing this, just wanting to serve at some capacity, you know, I'm a full-time mom with just volunteering and doing fundraising at my son's school, but then that gap that was missing. And just being able to, for him, he started like having me mentor a couple of ladies actually through Place of Hope. That's how it all began. And then from there it started growing. And then the more I kept praying, the more I kept learning about single moms. And truly, if it's not because of that void and that pain and that shame, knowing that I didn't have the courage that so many single moms, and not just single, but just women, have made despite their circumstances, despite their challenges, despite their finances, not having their family support, not having people around them, they've made the choice of giving life, a choice that I didn't make, ladies. And that is the reason why, Amy, I needed to be a voice for them. I'm just, Lord, just use me. I want to support them. And that's how he started bringing these organizations that I was learning through at different capacities so that I could serve single women and their children.
Isn't that beautiful?
Yes.
Beautiful. I mean, that's just wrapping up in a bow, you know? Music and pain for a purpose. I know that there are, we all, or a lot of us probably have, still some maybe things that we are carrying, you know, that we have made mistakes. What advice would you give those women that are still carrying something? How could they step into that freedom of truly letting it go?
Surround yourself with amazing sisters in Christ. Listen, my relationships changed completely after I gave myself to Christ when I was 38 or 39. One day, I'm going to know that date. I remember it so clearly, but I just want to have a date. I know the date of my baptism, which I'll share in a little bit, which was not that long ago. But surround yourself with amazing women that are going to be able to speak life into you, because we all need one another. And you know, you never know who has gone through that pain. Whatever your pain is, the Lord will bring people to help you walk through that journey. Bring it to Christ every single time. I just know that the beginning of my healing was recognizing my mistakes. I needed to do that. It was painful. And it took a little while. It was not like I'm recognized, I'm healed, and it was like right away. It did not happen like that. It took time to heal, to the point that I could not talk about it for so long either. Like, again, I chuckled here, but I'm thankful for this opportunity because I know that there's healing that needs to happen with so many women. And if it's just one, it's awesome because you gotta be freed from it. But just be patient and continue to press on and continue to heal. And he will continue to show you the steps that you have to make through it all. But just be deep in the word and just trust somebody. Talk about it with someone, and then suddenly you'll see that you're going to be spreading it, because that will become your message.
You know, you said something earlier that I think all of us have probably felt either now or at some point, that, you know, God, I did this horrible thing. Like, could you really use me? Like, real? I mean, could you really use me? You know, I think about, you know, you hear Christine Payne's story, or Joyce Meyer, if you're familiar with their stories, and like, something bad was done to them. So sometimes it's easy to have a story when it's, you've been hurt, but when you, as the Christian woman, make the mistake. So when you felt like God couldn't use you, had it, like you said, that was so wrong, which we know now. But those that maybe still be carrying that and still believing that, how did you fully get to that realization of going, you know what, no, that's not who you are, God. That's not your character. That's not your nature. I can be used by you.
Yeah.
And it can be amazing.
Amen.
And beautiful.
Amen.
Can you talk about that a little bit?
So there is power in testimony, ladies.
Amen.
Right? That's what the word in Revelation tells us. And that's the part that was so encouraging to me. It was listening to other women that have had a lot of pain, a lot of shame, a lot of their own experiences, that truly was the beginning of like, Lord, wow, if you can use them, you sure can use me. But I also had to come to a place of healing about it, because you gotta be filled before you can go ahead and give to others as well, right? But the power of testimony was truly what started working more and more within me. Realizing that I didn't have to live with this shame forever. And then again, just getting deep into the word, Amy, and worshiping him through every single circumstance. Ladies, the power of worship is mighty. When we are going through those dark valleys, that's when he wants to hear from us the most. And that's what is going to carry us so that we can get to the other end of that valley. And that's clearly what continues to happen again and again. And I'm thankful for that.
Thank you. You know, I think too, with what you just said, and it's something good to remember, is like when we're trying to just forgive ourselves or do it all, I mean, striving is so hard, but receiving is so easy,
right?
Like just receiving and accepting that forgiveness and knowing who he is. So, I love this question. I think God will love this too. At what point did you discover that you had this passion to help single moms? How many of you, right? You're not like, I'll turn my passion into that purpose. So what point did you discover your passion? And then how would you tell someone to discover their passion? And what would you tell them to pay attention to help them discover that?
So again, I just wanted to serve at some capacity, and I just continued to pray and pray and pray what that was going to be. And I honestly didn't know that it was going to be necessarily to serve single moms and their children. We do not serve just single moms. Please know that. It's the whole family. We have to attend to the whole family, because there's so much trauma that they themselves are encountering, and the children as well. But it truly was, number one, fully surrendering to knowing that there is a much deeper purpose that we are called for. When you get to that point, then you have to let go and let God. You have to let go of your fears. You have to let go of feeling ill-equipped or not enough, so that he can just use you in such a mighty way. Because otherwise that will keep us from truly stepping forward into what we're supposed to be doing. But my passion ignited from just that one step, and then him bringing people and teaching me, because I was absolutely clueless about the challenges that single moms go through. I've been married for so many years. I'm so glad that I had my boyfriend, now husband, every step of the way. I also have my family every step of the way. But just those little drops that the Lord puts and those little conversations, pay attention to that. And if it starts stirring you, really start paying attention to that. Because that was how he started working. And I say this, Amy, I said, if the Lord would have shown me the whole plan, I would have been running like the Jonah.
Yeah.
Hello. Not me. You surely got the wrong girl here, Lord. Because I am not worthy of all this. I am not enough. I am not equipped. I can't do this. I don't have a plan. Well, hello, he never shows us the plan. Right? He will show you the plan. But once you step into it, into the call. And so that's how little by little, as I started listening and I started tuning in and then connecting those dots of like, wow, so here is my pain. This is what I went through. This is my shame. How can I turn this into his higher purpose? That's how it all began. But just fully surrendering and really just being very, very close and intentional about listening. Like, again, what he says, who he brings. If it stirs you, start praying even harder, and he will show you the plan a little bit at a time.
So good. You know, and I know one of the prayers I started a couple years ago, wanting to be used by God. I mean, you want to be used by God, obviously. Like, you ladies, this is what refreshed women are. So, you know, I just asked the Lord, burden my heart for something. Like, you burden my heart. Not what maybe, you know, and he will. And what I love, what Angelique, that you shared about your journey is that you weren't waiting. Like last night, we talked all about waiting. What do we do? How do we wait well?
Right.
You were loving the Lord so much that you said, I just want to serve you.
Yeah.
I want to serve my family well. I'll volunteer at my kids' school. How can I serve? And you just kept showing up and serving well until he connected the dots.
Right.
Which was awesome. So I love this next question too. What advice would you give the younger version of yourself?
First and foremost, holy cow, I wish I knew the Lord way before then. It didn't take me that long to truly get to know him. He has, again, radically changed my life, and that's my desire for every single person, every single child. You know, from the very get-go, we get to now, as we know the Lord, we get to be able to pour into our children from the very beginning. That was not something that I had when I grew up. Again, we just kind of went to church, and for us, being Catholic was just a little different. Not to say that all Catholics are the same, because there's some amazing Catholics that are truly in the Word and on fire as well. It's just knowing it's not about true, you know, the denomination is just about that relationship. And so if that would be my one thing, is just yearning to have had that relationship, you know, from the very get-go, because it would have alleviated my journey so much more. I would have been able to definitely have more wisdom and be able to know exactly what to do and what and handle things better, right? Because we know that when we have him, we're really able to go through those dark seasons, but we just handle it in a different way as well.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, last question. When and who do you start to share the things that you've walked through to help others? Because like you said, you know, there was a season, sometimes, you know, we're not ready to share. How do we know kind of the right timing to share? And then how do you know when this can turn into your testimony?
It took me, like I say, it took me a little while to actually be able to do that. I couldn't talk about it. I didn't want anybody to know about it. But it really started doing life groups. Life groups are so important, ladies. Having your tribe, doing life together is so important. And I remember people would talk about it, but I couldn't. And I'm like, I'm not ready for this. I'm not ready for this. I'm like, Lord, no, I'm not gonna be, I just can't. I can't not confess what I have done. And the more I was able to pray about it, and again, getting those connections, those people that you trust is so important, that you're linking arms with that sister in Christ that is wise. Please let her be very wise so that she can also guide you through that. It's important. But it takes time. It's just starting somewhere that is really, really important, because then you'll see God work in an incredible way, and it's important to have that healing.
I lied, I have one more question.
Goodness.
Okay. If someone really has the desire to do something great and make a difference and wants to turn their pain into a bigger purpose, or they just really have the desire to want to help someone or make a difference, what advice would you give them, and where would you tell them to start?
You gotta start one step at a time. And please don't. So I just came from a conference, which, by the way, I was just baptized.
Woo!
Amazing. And before I go to that word, I just wanna say, I've been wanting to get baptized for the longest time, but I was being resistant because I wanted Angela's way. And Angela's way was doing it with her husband. But as Brooke Thomas, I was at her conference, and she gives you this opportunity to be able to sign up so you can get baptized in the Pacific Ocean. Wow. I remember I started feeling it out, and then I'm like, but I want to do it with my husband. I'm like, forget it, I'm not going to do it. So I put it to the side, and then the Lord used people, and they were coming, and they're like, I'm getting baptized today. And I'm like, oh, yay for you, not for me. And then I'm like, Lord, why am I feeling this way? Like, I know this is what you want me to do. This is what I want to do. I've been wanting to do it for so long. Like, this is so important. Water baptisms are so important, ladies. And, of course, coming to Christ first, your salvation, and then being baptized. But I was that morning, and I'm like, Lord, what do you want me to do? And it was so clear as day that my journey needed to be my journey, and his journey needed to be his own. My desire could not be his desire. And he's got me. So right away, I'm like, I'm committing, I'm doing it. And that's what happened that night. And it was just incredible. It was so, so good. But when there's those aha moments that also came from that. And the one thing that I want to share from the conference, so Jamie Kern Lima was there. She was one of the guest speakers. She was the founder of IT Cosmetics, or IT Cosmetics. I don't know if you're familiar with it. But again, what she did and how she started her business was incredible. I highly recommend her book. But she said right from the get-go, her mom was actually hospitalized the night before she was going to be speaking. She went over there three and a half hours away from where the conference was, and the Lord dropped a word in her. And she knew she needed to go back to conference to speak that word to someone in that room. And I'm going to share this word because I believe that this word is important, because I know that it was my breakthrough.
Wow.
Breakthrough. My breakthrough. So Brooke asked you, actually fill out a card right at the beginning of the conference, so that it asks, what is your breakthrough? What is the breakthrough that you want and that you need from God? And again, I haven't been equipped to do all this, ladies. I just wanted to start somewhere. And part of what I had to deal with, and I try to bring it to the Lord every single time, but it's that self-doubt. And self-doubt is not of the Lord. Do not let your doubt hold you back from what you need to do. But it was there. It was there. And I'm like, Lord, why does it continue to, I'm like, I know you are the one. Through my weakness, I'm going to be strong. You make me strong. This, you're equipping me. You are, these are your promises. You are there. You're not going to leave me nor forsake me. You didn't put me here for no reason. You have chosen me. You have appointed me. You have anointed me. You are doing a mighty work in me, but still, why am I going down back to that place again of doubt? Because the vision is way larger, ladies, than I could ever ask or imagine. Way big as doing the ministry, doing what we need to do to be able to serve more. We want to serve more. We want to love on more. But why? Why do I continue to go back there? And Jamie said, this is the word. If you don't feel worthy or enough, your self-doubt, it means that you're doubting God. Wait. You're doubting God. And I'm sitting at a table like yours, and I'm just like, boo-hooing. Because my self-doubt means that I am not trusting in God. And I'm telling myself that, yes, Lord, trust is harder than faith. For sure. But still, like, to self-doubt and doubt him, that's not a place that I want to be. And that was, like, I'm living it at the cross, ladies. That is it. I am ready to do whatever he wants me to do. And this is not a me, this is an us, this is a we. We have to step into it. But again, it's just starting with the smaller things and then just doing it. Just doing it. Don't allow your doubt or your fear to hold you back. No, you will not have the plan. He never gets the whole thing. He never gets the whole blueprint. But he blesses obedience. And from doing ministry, ladies, here we are. Well, we're going to bless the people that we're serving. Heck no. You know how much, personally, I have been blessed to be able to see God's hand at work every single time. Through ministry has been incredible. I have never experienced anything like that. Miracles. You pray, he listens. Can I share something really quick? Gosh, is it really quick? Well, I'm looking like, I don't know, I don't even know the time. I apologize. But this is so important because as you're doing ministry, you're in total dependence on him. So whatever you do, again, it doesn't have to be at this capacity and at a much larger capacity. It just needs to start somewhere, right? So I remember as we're serving the moms, there's so many different things that we want to make sure we're bringing all those wraparound services. And in 2020 alone, there was a huge need of transportation for the moms. Ladies, the Lord donated. He gave 6 cars to these moms. But wait until I tell you the kind of cars that he actually gave. And this is the awesomeness of it all. Like, seriously, I just want to jump. Because it is so good when you are doing his work and when you're fully obeying to his call, but you get to witness. It is such a privilege. Like, don't miss out on it. Do not miss out on it. I'm so glad that he brought me to the place where he needed to bring me. And I was able to just witness that. And so one of the cars, you know, Sonia,
yeah.
An awesome, awesome sister in Christ, she calls me, she goes, Ange, we need a car for Becca. And so right away, we always stop and pray. And this one was a very short prayer. And we said, Lord, we need a car for this mom and her daughter. She needs wheels. She needs to be able to get to work. And so we're like, in the name of Jesus, amen. So I go into a networking meeting. Actually, it was someone that I was meeting with, not networking, but I was meeting with her, and my phone is just going off the hook. And I'm like, okay, what's going on? And I didn't recognize the number. So I'm like, Jean, I'm sorry, I gotta hit pause. Clearly somebody is in need that needs me. And so this guy, John, he got the number from someone, another organization, and say, hey, Angela, I have a card that I would like to donate. They just gave me your number, and I just would like to give you my card. And I'm like, oh my God, Lord, like that was so quick. Like that was such a turnaround. I'm like, are you kidding me? I'm like, okay, John, so tell me about the card. He's like, well, it's a Crown Victoria, it's a big card. The trunk doesn't work. It doesn't look so great. But he's like, he can get you from point A to point B. It will be great for one of the moms. And I'm like, okay, John, so how many miles does this car have? And he goes, well, it do not judge a car by its color. And I'm like, oh, John, you're so emotionally attached to this car. I said, okay, so how many miles, John? And he goes, 425,000 miles. I'm like, oh, John, like, oh, Lord, like, yes, we asked for a car, but 425,000 miles? Yeah, Lord, we can give this car and to her daughter because it can break at any point, and we cannot leave them stranded. They're going to be inheriting a problem instead of a solution. So got back on the phone with Sonia, and I'm like, sister, I know what we did wrong. We did not pray in detail. Come on. How many of us know that our God is a God of details? So if you don't pray in details, you need to start doing it right now. So we started immediately praying. We're like, Lord, thank you so much for the blessing. But we need a safe, reliable, full mileage, good-looking car, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Sisters, 5 days later, he delivered in El Salvador. Come on. I had this friend moving to Wisconsin, an older lady, dear to my heart. Angela, I need to give you my car. Say what? I need to give you my car. It's a Nissan Altima that only had 23,000 miles.
Wow.
Beautiful red color and in great shape. That was the car that was given to a mom that is just trying. She's trying her best. And that's what happens. God, I talk about ministry and I go like crazy, my baby. That's what happens. They're going from survival mode, ladies, to thriving mode. Ladies, whosoever life you can touch. Don't wait. Don't hold back. Don't wait for the answer. Don't wait for we can get so stuck on praying, oh Lord, like show me. Oh, confirm another 1,000 times, please. Because surely this is not what you're asking me to do. Please, let go and let God, ladies. Because the blessings that come from that are amazing. They're going to blow you away. It's going to teach you so much. And it's not only you, but it's going to impact the rest of your family, the rest of the people that are around you, because now you're going to be able to say, I have been a witness of the Most High. I know what He's able to do. I know what He provides. I know how He can transform lives. And that's why you are going to become His messenger. And that's why you're going to become His hands and feet. Because again, He has prepared this well in advance, ladies. You got an assignment. Do it. Do it.
Wow. Do you guys help me appreciate Angela? I love the heart for moms. And so if you have a heart for moms, single moms, just moms, it doesn't matter, right? Like, it is heart for moms. Talk to Angela, you know, and learn more. There's so much ways. I've loved, you know, getting involved. And then I have a lady who's so soon. But I've tried to stay connected, y'all. But talk to Angela. It's just a great, great ministry. Obviously, you're so passionate, but God is moving and working in this ministry, and it has been so inspiring to see. And I just, again, I know his blessing, your obedience and your faithfulness. So just have a small token of our appreciation for you being here. And share with Angela, you know, how did she speak to you this morning?
I'm just over here boohooing. I love you. You were amazing. And I have a huge, huge heart for children. It's my life. And to hear what you're doing for their moms, generational curses are broken. And what you're doing, and just all the children, they're going to be impacted through you and through your ministry and through everything that you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Love you so much.
I just like to say, I think when he talks about like the abortion and stuff like that, that's something that I've always thought about. But I never wanted to talk about that. It was always so much easier to talk about all the other great things God has done for me and my family. But that's something that's always been there. And, you know, you have those conversations with him, and you can hear him sometimes saying, like, you know, don't worry, I love you. You know, keep moving forward. But it was just so good to hear that this could also be part of my story, and this could also be something that I could share with people. And it's been showing itself more and more. You know, I'm a high school teacher as well. And I have students who talk to me about, you know, just making the right decisions. And I always say, you know, if I knew what I knew now, I would have kept things so much more sacred. You know, I would have kept things so much, you know. And you just see the intimacy of, you know, how life is really supposed to be. And so God is so good like that. So. Thank you for giving us permission to use even the darkest things that we don't want to bring up to light.
I wanted to say thank you because my sister and I are byproducts of a single mother. So we would walk everywhere because we didn't have a car. So having a ministry like yours is really helping, you know, kids that were in our situation. And God blessed us with a church family and a school family that came and would give us baskets for Thanksgiving. They would give us Christmas gifts. And if it wasn't God's hand of protection, we wouldn't be who we are. We wouldn't be in grace. So what you're doing is impacting generations to come. It is so beautiful how God can just change things and use it for his glory. So thank you.
Thank you.